Hi, and welcome back to Mingus on Tech. I'm Ken Mingus, executive editor at Computer World. I'm here with Computer World's Lucas Mirian, Mr. Blockchain. We're going to talk about blockchain again because it's really hot and there's lots going on. Stick around. All right, Lucas, thanks for sticking around and coming back to talk about blockchain again. I know the last time you were on, we were kind of going through the basics of what blockchain is and how it seems to be rolling out in lots of different industries. And since then, a couple things have happened, a couple stories you've written about that I thought were really interesting. And I just wanted to get a little bit more information about what's going on and where we think this stuff is headed this year. So let's start first with Maersk.
Maersk.
It's a global shipping company,
yeah.
Is it? Okay.
Biggest.
And they've teamed up with IBM.
Yep.
To work with IBM's blockchain to do something that could be fairly radical for global shipping if it works the way Maersk thinks it's going to work.
So
what's going on there exactly?
So global shipping right now is the way that they track it is a little archaic. It's paper-based, it's EDI-based, but it's not really cloud-based. People can't see transactions in real time. For customs agents can't clear them in real time. Manufacturers can't see where their products are in real time. And the folks who are purchasing the products can't see where they are in real time. And oftentimes, because it's tracking systems are rather archaic, you can have goods sitting in ports for days or in some cases weeks before they actually get delivered because they're waiting on approvals. Acceptance.
And as we know, time is money.
Yes, indeed.
So the point here is that you've got this huge industry, global shipping, that is reliant on all kinds of, I guess, as you say, archaic, but legacy systems to track where everything is, where it's shipping out of, whether it's, cleared customs, whether it's been distributed the way it should be. Mm-hmm. And so Maersk, which is one of these big shipping companies, has decided that by using blockchain, it can create a platform that will allow not only it, but I guess other shippers as well, to track everything basically all at once. And everyone can sort of see in real time with a lot of transparency where everything is.
Right. Unlike Bitcoin, it's not an open ledger. It's a permissioned or private ledger. So it'll be shared among the parties involved. IBM's basically enabling it through their cloud blockchain service. But they've created the two, they've invested so heavily in this, they've actually created a third company so that they don't think that this technology is proprietary just for Maersk. They're also offering it to other shipping companies and manufacturers with other shipping companies. That tells you how invested they are in this. They've actually created a third company to do this. It's going to create a lot of efficiencies. So anyone, for example, let's say that I'm a manufacturer and my customer is waiting for the goods. If the invoice doesn't match with the exact number of goods that have arrived in that port, so let's say 99% have arrived, but that 1% somehow didn't arrive, you're going to be able to track what happened to them. And you're going to be able to clear that invoice faster because of that. Because if you're purchasing product and you notice some are missing, you may not pay that invoice until they figure out what happened to the missing product.
Right. So this is something that could theoretically, once it's up and running, cut down on theft.
Basically. Oh, absolutely.
When things fall off a truck in mid-shipment and something doesn't arrive, you'll know right away. The shipping company or whoever's expecting it will know right away and then can backtrack because of the blockchain and see exactly where that thing, the shipment went and came from.
And fraud. Because the blockchain has a nascent ability to determine who is on that blockchain, who's authorized to be on that blockchain. So you're not going to have somebody coming in stealing or creating false goods to be shipped or to be purchased or on the other end to be bought.
Okay. So it takes care of fraud. And the idea being that this will also speed up the entire process of getting goods from port A to port B and distributed, because you can also have government officials in different countries. It's global, which is, you've got all of these systems. None of them necessarily work well together.
Right.
When this system is in place, the blockchain system, everybody's on the same
wavelength.
Same system, yeah. Same wavelength, exactly. Yeah. And so if there's some holdup at customs, you can track that down and get it taken care of quickly. If there's some delay because of, you know, weather or whatever, you'll know that the shipment's been delayed. So Maersk is planning to roll this out this year? Is that
I think within
the
next
company
3 to 6
that they've
months.
Created.
Yeah. The company they've created is going to be, they need to get some authorizations first, again, from government authorities. Who will probably check it and test it to make sure that it can, in fact, meet standards. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, I think within probably three months, maybe six at the outside, they're looking to have this online.
Are there any security issues, or is it because it's a private sort of closed blockchain, does that make it more secure in that you won't have outside third parties that shouldn't be involved in this dipping in and maybe mucking things up?
Absolutely. And it's hashed. It's encrypted. So you, without authorization, you're not going to be able to see the data in there anyways. So it definitely increases security. That's a big part of this is the security aspect, which we talked about.
And Maersk has been saying that they expect this globally, once it's up and running, to save billions?
Yeah, they're claiming billions of dollars, which in the shipping industry in general,
it's a
multi-trillion dollar industry. So billions is not out of the realm of possibilities.
A billion here, a billion there, and eventually you've got a cost-saving blockchain.
Absolutely.
Okay. So that was the first one. I found that interesting that, you know, global shipping and you know, is getting into this. But what really piqued my interest was the story that you've got up now about, it's FileZilla?
Well, it's not. FileZilla is an FTP client that's going to be using it, but it's about some startups that are actually going to use blockchain to manage peer-to-peer storage.
Yeah, the idea of peer-to-peer storage that it's going to be managed using the blockchain, but it's going to be the sort of thing where anybody that's got some extra storage lying around that kind of wants to get into this might be able to jump in and have this pool of storage, which would be much cheaper than other, you know, cloud storage. So how does that work? How do they envision this blockchain, you know, working?
Sure. Well, in the early 2000s, I don't remember, there were some efforts to use peer-to-peer technology to share CPU capacity. Mm-hmm. So your home computer, maybe data centers where all the servers weren't up and spinning at
the
time.
Was that like the SETI thing? Remember SETI?
Yeah, when you SETI.
Was like, that was a sort of peer-to-peer shared resources, right?
Perfect example. Yep, yeah. SETI. They were using consumer and business computers, excess CPU capacity, in order to explore, you know, possibility of,
I don't think we've been contacted
life.
Yet that we know of.
Not but, that we know of.
Yeah, exactly. All right.
Know, just so, believe.
All right. So that's how peer-to-peer, you're sharing the resources. And
you're sharing the resources. What's different about this is that you get paid for sharing your resources, and you didn't before. Okay. There's a method, because there's cryptocurrency tied to blockchains, you can actually be paid in cryptocurrency for sharing that CPU and network capacity.
So if I've got, 2 terabytes, 4 terabytes mm-hmm. lying around, and I want in on this shared pool, mm-hmm. I can join this this blockchain system, and by sharing my extra storage, I will get some money on a monthly basis, I guess?
Yeah, it's not a lot. So if it's 2 terabytes, I think the estimate is about $8 a month. But it's $8 in cryptocurrency, whose value has gone up.
Which could be $8 billion next month.
Right.
And 8 cents the month after that.
It's like handing somebody stocks. You know, they might not be worth a lot at that moment, but they grow over time. And with cryptocurrency, you know, who knows if it's going to continue to, but it has grown tremendously.
Yeah. All right. So what's FileZilla's role in this there?
So FileZilla is a online file sharing service. Mm-hmm. It's a FTP client, for lack of a better term. And they're hoping to change from, I think they use SourceForge now for the basis of the file sharing, to a blockchain-based file sharing method, just the same way. I think they're using Storage Labs, S-T-O-R-J Labs,
Storage.
Blockchain. They're the startup, and they're in partnership with them right now to do that over the next year. One of the problems with these blockchain services is blockchain has a problem with scaling.
Yep.
So storage started about a year and a half ago. It grew tremendously, and now they're having issues with scaling because nascently blockchain tends to eat up a lot of CPU.
Because every time you add a block to the chain, you're using more and more resources.
Every single node in that blockchain, then records it. So it can exponentially use CPU resources over time. So they're working on a way to use fewer nodes to process the transactions while still keeping the highly secure and distributed properties of blockchain. The same thing that's happening with Ethereum, which is an organization that actually puts out a blockchain specification that a lot of other industries use. And right now, they're trying to figure that same problem out, again, by using just a few nodes to process the transactions, which would eat up less CPU power, and while still using the network to store what is actually a very small amount of data to confirm each block.
So these nodes would be almost like a second level of blockchain that you would use to keep it from scaling so far.
Outside the blockchain itself.
It's outside the blockchain. Yeah. And the idea there is that you can create blockchains that are not so completely CPU intensive that they basically scale themselves out of existence.
Exactly. Yeah, that's the problem right now, is that they scale very quickly. You know, as you look at things like Bitcoin, I mean, I don't even know how many nodes are involved in that, but I'm sure millions upon millions of nodes at this point. These are nascent, smaller iterations, but when they start taking on clients, again, they scale very quickly. FileZilla actually told me that they used it. They said it was very smooth, worked well, but they saw the performance issues almost right off the bat. Now, storage said, okay, what we're going to do is we're going to shut down any new clients. We're not going to take on any new node. They call them farmers, people who allow you to use the CPU and network capacity or storage capacity. I'm sorry, storage or network capacity of a home computer, home server, or excess capacity in a data center.
Mm-hmm.
Those are called farmers. They're not going to take on any new farmers. And they're also not going to take on any new clients until they figure out how to address the scaling problem. So they announced that last week. They think it's going to take could take up to 6 months, but you know they figure stitch in time saves nine. You don't want to continue to grow when you can't really address one of the problems.
Right. It's smart to get ahead of that because they obviously see that you know this isn't going to work indefinitely.
Right.
All right. I can understand. So you know if I've got a couple of computers. Mm-hmm. I've got some extra storage. I'm connected, and I want to sell off that extra storage. You know, as a person, and I get my bitcoins every month worth whatever they're worth.
Mm-hmm.
For a company, you know, that maybe has some excess data center capacity, you know, are there any dangers to the company that's you know, I guess, is that the farmers that are farming it out?
I think the farmers, the company would call farmers too.
Yeah. Any dangers that, like, you know, there might be some sort of commingling of data or something like that? Or is this pool of blockchain-governed storage basically walled off from everything that I'm doing with my business or my personal computer or whatever?
Yeah, it's absolutely walled off and, again, encrypted.
Okay.
So it can't be accessed by anybody else in the company because they don't have the hash.
Okay.
Excuse me, the hash.
Yeah. All right. So basically, we know blockchain is like has taken the world by storm, first with cryptocurrencies, Bitcoin, et cetera.
Yeah.
It's obviously evolving out into different areas now, you know, again, global shipping, cloud storage, P2P, blockchain managed cloud storage.
Mm-hmm.
And I think in the story that you've got up today, one of the selling points here was that the storage that people that somebody might be able to access using this blockchain-based system is much cheaper than they would get with regular cloud storage.
Vastly cheaper. This really, it's nascent, but
right.
It could challenge things like AWS and other cloud storage services that are out there right now. Dropbox,
just because it's so cheap.
Yeah, it's I think one of the companies is claiming 10 times cheaper than AWS, than Amazon, sorry, Amazon
so
storage.
So basically a theoretically almost unlimited pool of storage, crowdsourced, managed by a secure blockchain, and one-tenth the cost of what somebody might be paying a cloud storage provider now.
And you can be using that storage and offering it up at the same time. So you can offer, you know, excess storage capacity, network capacity on your computer while at the same time, allowing excess resources to be used and pay for.
What's not to love?
I did want to mention there's one of the three companies I mentioned in the article. So you have Storage Labs, Filecoin, and SIA, SIA. SIA said they have a different architecture where they're only using 50 nodes or computers to store anyone's data, so they don't have the same scaling problems. I'm not an expert on this. I don't know if that's a solution. It could be they claim that they don't have the same scaling issues. So I did want to mention that while other blockchains are trying to address the scaling issues here, allegedly, you know, they don't stripe the data across hundreds or thousands of computers. They just use 50 for each data set. Yeah.
It's interesting that they're basically talking about doing the same thing, you know, in terms of coming up with this, you know, Uber level, if you will, above the blockchain that allows for, you know, things to be managed without scaling out of sight.
Right.
And it's, you know, that scaling issue does seem to be the one drawback that might really slow things down as company. I mean, I know there's lots of test projects going on, lots of pilots going on right now. Everybody's scrambling to see how they can make this work and save money. But if that scaling issue isn't resolved, I think they're going to hit a pretty sizable speed bump.
Yeah, and that's why Ethereum is they're really concerned about addressing this. They're doing something called sharding, I think, S-H-A-R-D-I-N-G, which is that the concept of only using a few nodes outside the blockchain to address the processing capacity for the blockchains themselves. Because it's not a lot of data that's being stored. It's a very small amount of data, basically. It's metadata that's being stored to identify who it is that the information is going to, the individual blocks.
Mm-hmm.
So if they can fix that, if they can fix the actual CPU scaling issue, I think the future for blockchain is extremely bright.
Yeah, it sure sounds like it. And it certainly sounds like 2018 is going to be the year that we're going to find out whether these pilot projects really do work, really do deliver, and really can save companies lots of money.
Absolutely.
And if they find that to be true and they deal with the scaling issue, you got a whole new industry.
Yeah, and now you're going from pilots in 2017, 2016 to real world rollouts in 2018. So, yeah, this is the year I think we're going to see just how applicable this is to different industries.
Okay, so there you have it, 2018, the blockchain breakout year. Lucas, thanks for the update. Sure. Like I say, I did want to find out what's going on now, and of course, I will have you back later on so we can figure out whether or not global shipping has come to a screeching halt or is still moving forward. I think it'll be fine.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot. I appreciate the update. Sure. For now, that's a wrap.